Good morning.
Good morning.
Hey, is everybody doing okay today?
Yes.
Cool. Weather's turning warm. Isn't that great?
Yes.
I love summertime. Amen. I know I have a few people around who just wait till July and August. You know, I've been in this community since July and August. We lived in Fort Walton for years, so I know what it means to sit and watch water run down your windows, you know, on the inside. And with the air conditioner running like crazy, I do get that. But I love summertime. It's my favorite time of the year. And so I don't mind sweating a little bit. I can't put enough clothes on during the wintertime. So, but I can, yeah. But I can enjoy summertime. I can enjoy summertime. No, quite. All right, you've already done it. There it was. Boom. Hey, if you're a guest with us, thanks for being here this morning. We're glad to see you. And in your worship folder, there's a little panel on the right. If you'll simply tear that off and give us some information about you. In fact, if you'll bring this with you after service, go out this hallway, turn right, and go to the end of the library. I'll be down there to greet you. And if you're a guest, you're a celebrity with us here at EHBC, because we believe that celebrities ought to get a goodie bag, and we got a goodie bag for you down there. If you'll come down, I'll be glad to meet you by name, get to know you, and give you a goodie bag. So we're glad to see you. There's other information in here that you may want to, if you're a member, you may want to fill out some information about, like you're going to be here Wednesday night, let us know that you're going to be here, therefore we can have enough food for everybody, all that good stuff. So you know what? I think it's really important right now that we gather our hearts and our minds together, that we go to the Lord in prayer and invite Him to come join us. How about that? Would you do that with me? Father, we thank You for this time of worship. And I know we gather together, we get to see friends, we get to enjoy company, we get to have a great time. And Father, these folks on this stage are going to help us to have a great time and to worship from the heart. We pray Your blessings on them as they lead us. But Father, we'd invite You to come and join with us. You have promised where two or three or more are gathered in Your name, You'd be there. And we do understand that. And we do understand You keep Your promises and You will be here. But Father, we invite You to come because we want You here. This is all about You. Our worship time is all about You. It's all about glorifying You, lifting You up, learning of You and from You, and blessing You. So, Father, receive our worship today in Jesus' name. Amen.
He came to live a perfect life. He came to be the living Word of life. He came to die so we'd be reconciled. He came to rise to show His power and might. That's why we praise Him, and that's why we sing. That's why we offer Him our everything. That's why we bow down and worship this King, 'cause He gave His everything. He gave His everything. He came to live again in us. He came to be our conquering King and friend. He came to heal, to show the lost ones His love. He came to go prepare a place for us. That's why we praise Him, and that's why we sing. That's why we offer Him our everything. That's why we bow down and worship this King, 'cause He gave His everything. 'Cause He gave His everything. That's why we praise Him, and that's why we sing. That's why we offer Him our everything. That's why we bow down and worship this King, 'cause He gave His everything. 'Cause He gave His everything. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. That's why we praise him, and that's why we sing. That's why we offer him our everything. That's why we bow down and worship this King, because he gave his everything. Because he gave his everything. That's why we praise him, and that's why we sing. That's why we offer him our everything. That's why we bow down and worship this King, because he gave his everything. Because he gave his everything. That's why we praise him, and that's why we sing. That's why we offer him our everything. That's why we bow down and worship this King, because he gave his everything. Because he gave his everything. Because he gave his everything. We want to see, we want to see, we want to see Jesus lifted high. We want to see, we want to see, we want to see Jesus lifted high. We want to see Jesus lifted high. A banner that flies across this land, that all men might see the truth and know he is the way to heaven. We want to see Jesus lifted high. A banner that flies across this land, that all men might see the truth and know he is the way to heaven. We want to see, we want to see, we want to see Jesus lifted high. We want to see, we want to see, we want to see Jesus lifted high. Step by step we're moving forward, little by little taking ground. Every prayer a powerful weapon, strongholds come tumbling down and down and down and down. We want to see Jesus lifted high. A banner that flies across this land, that all men might see the truth and know he is the way to heaven. Hey, we want to see, we want to see, we want to see Jesus lifted high. We want to see, we want to see, we want to see Jesus lifted high. We want to see, we want to see, we want to see Jesus lifted high. We want to see, we want to see, we want to see Jesus lift. Gonna see, we're gonna see, we're gonna see, we're gonna see Jesus lifted high. We're gonna see, we're gonna see, we're gonna see Jesus lifted high. Over all the earth, you reign on high. Every mountain stream, every sunset sky. But my one request, Lord, my only aim, is that you reign in me again. Lord, reign in me, reign in your power. Over all my dreams, in my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all I am. You reign in me again. every thought, over every word. May my life reflect the beauty of my Lord, 'cause mean more to me than any earthly thing. So won't you reign in me again, Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams in my darkest hour, 'cause you are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again, Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams in my darkest hour, for you are the Lord of all I am. Won't you reign in me again? Over all the earth, you reign on high. Every mountain stream, every sunset sky. But my one request, Lord, my only aim, is that you reign in me again. Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams in my darkest hour, 'cause you are the Lord of all I am. Won't you reign in me again, Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams in my darkest hour, for you are the Lord of all I am. Won't you reign in me again?
Did you know that today is the last message in the series, The Significant Seven? Did you know that? It is. We've gone through all, or six of them. We're going to go through the last one of the Significant Seven this morning. And next week, we're launching a new series called Igniting Spiritual Passion, a walk through the book of 1 Peter. So we're just going to take the book of 1 Peter and walk all the way through it. It'll take us a long time. We'll have a few intermissions every once in a while for special things. So I just want you to know, starting next week, if you want to get a good running commentary of the book of 1 Peter, have a great time not just doing the historical look, but seeing how it applies today, you're going to have a great time as we start that series next week, Igniting Spiritual Passion. Right now, I want to put you through a test. Are you ready? Sure. Marcia's always ready. Just okay, so get a pen or pencil. You ready? You gotta do this, okay? This, if you don't get the pen and pencil out, it won't work, okay? Gary said, I don't have a pen. I don't have a pencil. Okay, your wife is helping you out. There you go. There you go. You got friends. Okay, this is a word association test. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to say a word, and I want you to write down that word and then something next to it that you associate with that word. First thing that comes into your mind, don't think about it. This isn't one of those, well, let me think. Once you start thinking about it, you ruin the whole thing, okay? So I'm going to give you a word, write that down, then whatever thought comes to mind, whatever word comes to mind right after that. Are you ready? Okay, here we go. Boy. Second word, milk. Don't, some of you are thinking too long. Third word, home. H-O-M-E, home. Fourth word, grass. G-R-A-S-S. All right, I can hear a few, yeah, there's. Number, fifth word, drive. D-R-I-V-E, drive. Sixth word, door, D-O-O-R. Next to the last word, church. All right, and the final word, power, P-O-W-D-B-O-W-E-R, power. Okay, if you're concerned about how you did or what your answers might mean, see me after worship, okay? Because you know how this thing works, right? What you associate with tells you a lot about where your thinking is, okay? Let's talk a little bit about that last possible answer, power, and what words you might associate with that. There are all kinds of words that can be associated with power, such as more, abuse, political. You can have all kinds of stuff that you say power and associate power with. Which one you chose depends on where you've camped out in your life. And that's how these word association tests work. If you look at these tests, what they help a screener do is to screen where you've been and then what you're doing, what you're associating from where you've been. For instance, if I told you mother, most people would say father. But if you had an abusive mother, you might say abuse. You see what I'm saying? So when you look at this word power and you say, well, what's this help me to see about me? Scripturally speaking, power can be defined in two ways. Okay? First way is authority. As in, God has the power to tell us what to do. Or God has the authority to tell us what to do. That's one way you can use the word and defines the word power. Second way, biblically speaking, you use the word power is as an ability, like God has the power to heal, or God has the ability to heal. If we don't understand when we read the word power in the Bible, what's being said there, we may misinterpret what's going on, right? We need to know what's the difference between authority and ability. All real authority comes from God. Did you know that? I don't care what kind of authority you're talking about, all real authority comes from God. According to Romans 13:1, the Bible says every person is to be in subjection to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those which exist are established by God. You're saying, are you kidding me? I mean, this is written by a guy who was underneath the thumb of Rome, right? It was probably in jail, in fact. He was up for trial anyway. And he's writing that even in Roman authority, even in governmental authority, even in civil authority, all authority originates with God, and God has to allow it. That's the reason why, folks, we have to pray when it comes to who we're going to elect for anything. Even if we're going to elect somebody for dog catcher, you better pray about it. Because all authority comes from God, and sometimes God exercises authority over the United States by allowing us to elect a scoundrel. Sometimes he exercises authority over the United States by giving us a great leader. So you have to pray. And you want God's best for our country, amen? So you better be praying about these things. Don't just take it for granted. Don't just say, well, I like him, I like her. Ask, what does God want? Because all authority originates with God. We need to know that. And because we are created by God and in his image, all human abilities stem from him as well. So you have authority stems from him and abilities stem from him. So what are we saying? All power belongs to God and all power stems from him. Whether you're talking about authority or abilities. Now, are you aware, when it comes to abilities, the average person has over 700 identifiable abilities? Are you aware of that? I mean, how many of you people in here consider yourself at least average? Okay, at least average. Some of you are far more than average, right? So you at least have 700 identifiable abilities. You do. And there are some people who say, well, I don't have any talents. Well, yeah, you do. You got at least 700 identifiable ones. 700. But as Phillips Brooks said, quote, it is almost as presumptuous to think that you can do nothing as to think that you can do everything. People say, well, I just don't have any abilities. I just don't have any talents. That's just not right. That's false humility. It may even be pride in reverse. You got to understand something. God has given you some abilities. God has given you some things you can do, but he's also given you limitations just like he has everybody else. We all have abilities. We all have limitations. All of those things come from God. If you don't understand your abilities, you won't fulfill God's purposes for your life. If you don't understand your limitations, you're going to be frustrated all your life. Amen? You've got to know what you can do, and you've got to know what you can't do. Because I know one thing. I've seen a lot of great golfers ruin some great tournaments because they tried to do something they couldn't do. Greg Norman was the greatest of it. You know, he went into the Masters one year with a 9-stroke lead on the last day and didn't win because he didn't know his limitations. I thought, my goodness gracious, he was at the time the greatest player in golf. There's lots of things we can do and lots of things we can't do. Without the help of some mechanical apparatuses, for instance, we can't fly. Now, all of us can fly. We can get an airplane, right? We can pay the ticket fare, get an airplane, fly in where we want to go, but not without the mechanical apparatus. None of us can fly. All of us can get scuba equipment if we want to and go underneath the water for a little bit, but not without mechanical equipment. We can't stay under there for very long. Most people, less than 2 minutes. Some remarkable people, almost 5 minutes. But beyond that, with that mechanical equipment, you're not going to be down underwater very long. You see, we have our limitations, and we got to understand those. Just as we have physical limitations, we also have spiritual limitations. Those spiritual limitations are also defined by God himself. He set those limitations. Amen? You got to know this. We cannot get to heaven on our own, for example. There's a limitation of how far we can go spiritually. We cannot get to heaven on our own. But there are three specific things we cannot do, and we need to know them spiritually speaking. I want to give them to you this morning. Three very specific things that you cannot do, and listen to me carefully. I'm going to make this statement, and you're going to freak for just a minute. But we cannot do them unless we're baptized in the Holy Spirit. You listening to me? You need to know these things. Okay? We're gonna know what they are. I'm gonna give them to you real quick, and then we're gonna go through them. Number one is we cannot learn. Number two, we cannot love. Number three, we cannot live. So let's look at them more in depth. You ready to do that? Okay, number one, we cannot learn. That is to learn, I mean by that, acquire spiritual understanding. We cannot acquire spiritual understanding without the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Do you realize that without the presence of the Holy Spirit, we also don't have the ability, that is the power, to gain spiritual knowledge? We just can't do it. It's been shown that we learn by our various senses in differing ways. We learn 1% through our taste, 1.5% through our touch, 3.5% through our smell, 11% through our hearing, 83% through our sight. But that's not how we gain any spiritual knowledge. Not a one of those things help us gain spiritual knowledge. So we just don't know how. And it has to come from God. Romans 10:17 says, so faith comes from hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We get spiritual understanding through the word of God. And if we don't have the baptism of the Holy Spirit, we can't understand the word of God. You know, I used to try to read the Bible when I was a lost guy. We'd take these golf trips in college, and all the golf guys would go off, and, you know, on the end of the day, they'd go out honky-tonking. I was back in my room because I had a girlfriend that told me, you ever do that, and that's it. I said, okay. So I sat back in my room while the other guys went out and did their thing. And so the only thing to really do in the rooms where they had a Gideon Bible, I'd get the Gideon Bible out and I'd try to help myself overcome this temptation. I'd read the Gideon Bible. Well, it was just, I didn't know. It might as well have been a Greek textbook. I had no idea what I was reading. I'd open it up. I'd start at different places. I usually tried to start in the New Testament, Matthew, and when I get to that part, it says, if your hand calls you to sin, cut it off, and whoop, we're done with that. We'll go somewhere else. It just didn't make any sense to me whatsoever. And I just could not understand, how does this help anybody? You know what? When I got saved, you could just open up a Bible and I could really teach from it. And it was just pouring out. I thought, what? This is so awesome. Man, I was devouring the Word of God. I couldn't get enough of it. Every time I had a spare moment, I had my Bible out. I was studying. I was learning. I was growing. I was just eating it up. And I thought, this is the same book I couldn't read just a couple of months ago? Well, this is crazy. The difference was, a couple of months ago, I didn't have the presence of the Holy Spirit to teach me what was in God's Word. Hearing just isn't enough. We know that. Jesus said, if anyone has ears to hear, let him hear, Mark 4:23. So it's those who can hear the word of God, but those who can't don't grasp the implications of it. Even the disciples who walked with Jesus every day couldn't comprehend what he was saying until they later themselves received the Holy Spirit, and then they could understand, and then they went about teaching everybody all things whatsoever Jesus had taught them. Are you following me so far? Okay. Because this is really important stuff. In John chapter 14, verse 25 and 26, Jesus said this, these things I have spoken to you while abiding with you, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I said to you. So whose job is it to teach us? Holy Spirit. Now, part of my job is to teach you the Word of God. The Holy Spirit takes what I teach and helps you have an understanding of it and brings it to mind at the proper time in your daily life when you need that thing. Okay? And so I'm God's teacher and equipper to you, but He is your constant daily inner teacher, which I can't be with you all day long. That's still true. If you look at how God teaches people, it's the same way He's taught them down through the ages. It's through God's called men, explain the Word of God and the Holy Spirit bringing it to light in your life. That's how it works. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9 through 14 says this, but just as it is written, things which eye hath not seen and ear hath not heard, and which have not entered into the heart of man, all that God has prepared for those who love Him. For to us God revealed them through the Spirit. How? Through the Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, even the depths of God. For who among men knows the thoughts of a man except the spirit of the man which is in him? Even so, the thoughts of God no one knows except the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, so that we may know the things freely given to us by God. Which things we also speak, not in words taught by human wisdom, but in those taught by the Spirit, combining spiritual thoughts with spiritual words. But a natural man, listen to this, but a natural man, what is a natural man? It's someone who hasn't been saved. Someone who hasn't been converted. Someone who doesn't have the Spirit of God. Listen to me. But the natural man does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, and he cannot understand them. Did you catch that? Doesn't mean he just doesn't. It means he can't. He doesn't have the ability. He doesn't have the power. He cannot understand them. Why? Because they are spiritually appraised. Or if you like the King James, spiritually discerned. What's that mean? Without the Spirit of God, none of us could know anything spiritually speaking whatsoever except what we want to make up on our own. It wouldn't be right. There is a way that seemeth right unto the man, that ends thereof of the ways of destruction. We just make up something. Sounds good to us. What's going on all around us nowadays? People are making up stuff. They're just deciding what they want spiritual life to be like. They make it up and say, this is what I believe it is. And therefore, since I believe it, it's true. That's not the case. It is true only if God says it is true. Are you with me? The second thing we cannot do is we cannot love. That is, we cannot love people unconditionally like God loves. Now, without the indwelling Holy Spirit, we don't really have the power to love, to be purely committed to someone else's best interest by our attitude and our actions. You know, that's what love is, right? I've given you that definition over and over and over. You're going to be able to spout it back to me one of these days. Dr. Ron, I know what love is. Love is my commitment to someone else's best interest by my attitude and my actions. Anything less is slurpy sentimentalism or infatuation or lust or whatever you want to call it. But it doesn't qualify to be love. In the Greek language of the New Testament, there are several words that get translated into our English word love. For instance, storge, S-T-O-R-G-E. Storge is the Greek word for family love. Natural love, like for mother, for a child. Storge, S-T-O-R-G-E. There's also eros, E-R-O-S. That's passionate love or romantic love, eros. There's the word philia, P-H-I-L-I-A, which is brotherly love, like I have for my brothers or what I have for you. We have a brotherly or sisterly love for each other. And then there's one that's agape, and you've heard this one before, I'm sure, A-G-A-P-E, agape. That's God love. That's a love that can love unconditionally regardless if it gets anything back in return. Okay? That's a tough kind of love. It's the love Jesus commanded us to have for our neighbor, Matthew 22, verse 39, and for one another in the church, John 13, 34. We're to have agape love. Can we have this kind of agape love if we don't have God? Well, no, because it's who's the source of this kind of love? God is. He's the source of all authority and all ability. So therefore, I don't have the ability to love somebody unconditionally if I don't have God. I might be able to love them in a brotherly love. I might be able to love them in a passionate romantic love. I might be able to love them in some kind of a family type love, but I can't love them unconditionally. Number one, because I don't even know what that is if I don't have God. I've never experienced it myself. And number two, I don't have the ability. That ability to love that way comes from God. Does it start to make sense to you? While we're talking about power, we need the power, we need the authority and the ability to love unconditionally. God-like love is impossible without the Holy Spirit living inside the believer. Listen to Luke chapter 6, verse 27 through 32. This is a great passage. It says, but I say to you who hear, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who mistreat you. Whoever hits you on the cheek, offer him the other also, and whoever takes away your coat, do not withhold your shirt from him either. Give to everyone who asks of you, and whoever takes away what is yours, do not demand it back. Treat others the same way you want them to treat you, and if you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners love those who love them. So Jesus is saying, let me describe agape love to you. And we look at that and said, how in the world can anybody do that? Well, God, nobody can. God can. So God has to do that through us. And if we don't have God, we can't do that either. Does that make sense? Okay, I'm wanting you to see it. A sinner, in this case, when he says sinner's love, he's not talking about someone who sins. We get confused in the church and we call each other sinner. If you're in the church, if you know the Lord Jesus Christ, you are not a sinner. Did you know that? You need to stop referring to yourself as a sinner. If you're a born-again child of God, you have the presence of the Holy Spirit in you, you are not a sinner. Now, you may sin, but you are not a sinner. A sinner is one who is separated from God. Are you separated from God? No. So if you once were separated from God, you once were a sinner, and you're now no longer a sinner, what are you now? You're a saint. You are a saint. That's what you are. When you got saved, the presence of the Holy Spirit came into you. You ceased being someone separated from God, and you became someone who was connected to God and His family. You are no longer a sinner. You are now a saint. You've been transferred from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of God's dear Son. You need to quit referring to yourself as a sinner. You are a sinner saved by grace. Therefore, that makes you a saint. Listen to me carefully. Get your verbiage right, because you know what? You will begin to act out what you say about yourself. If you keep calling yourself a sinner, guess what you're going to continue to do? You're going to continue to sin. Why? Because you believe that's your job. Job of a sinner is to what? Sin. Job of a saint is to what? Live saintly. See, if you've heard of yourself as a saint, you'll understand who you are and what you're supposed to be like. Stop referring to yourself as a sinner. You're not a sinner any longer. Well, I sin every once in a while. Well, okay, you're a flawed saint. Like the rest of us. Okay? Just want you to get this down pat. You need to know this. Look with me at Romans chapter 5, verse 5. Romans 5, 5. It tells us the difference between a sinner and a saint. Listen to this. Because this is wonderful. The Bible says, and hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been what? Poured out within our hearts through the Holy Spirit who was given to us. When did we get this love of God? When we got the Holy Spirit. This is simple. See, it's not rocket science. You just have to understand how the Bible is put together. You now have the love of God poured out in you. You now can love agape. Why? Because God is in you. How did God get in you? Through the Holy Spirit that was given to you. Wow. So, without the presence of the Holy Spirit, you can't learn. Without the presence of the Holy Spirit, you can't love. And without the presence of the Holy Spirit, you can't live. Okay? That's the third thing. What do I mean by live? I mean live a godly life. You can exist without the Holy Spirit. And there's lots of people out here existing without the Holy Spirit. People are not living. Jesus said, I have come that they have life and have it more abundantly. John 10:10. That's not in the notes, but I wanted to throw it in there anyway. Okay? You can't live an abundant life without the presence of the Holy Spirit. Once you have the presence of the Holy Spirit, what are you supposed to live? An abundant life. It's what we're supposed to live. I just need you to know that. We don't have the power to conduct our lives righteously without the presence of the Holy Spirit. That's the reason why when we were sinners, what did we do? We sinned all the time. Once we got saved, we now have the presence of the Holy Spirit. What are we not supposed to do? Sin all the time. Why? Because we now have the power, the ability to live righteously. This one's so simple. If it were possible to live righteously without the presence of the Holy Spirit, do you think God would have sent Jesus to go through all the mess that he went through, suffer like he suffered, and get on a cross and die for your sins if it could have been avoided? No. Why would God be so cruel? If just by telling you, do right, D, just do right, D, you could do right, then why would Jesus have to come and die? See, we just didn't have the capacity, we just didn't have the power to live righteously prior to coming to faith in Jesus Christ. No one else does either. Listen to me carefully. There's not a soul who has ever lived on this planet who can live righteously apart from the Lord Jesus Christ. You hear me? I don't care who they are. I don't care whose grandmother they are. I don't care how sweet a little baby they are. It's just not going to happen. Because if it was possible even just for one, then God is the most cruel of all beings to send Jesus to suffer like he did. We all inherited the sinful nature of Adam, and apart from saving faith in Jesus Christ and the gift of the Holy Spirit, we would all live selfish lives. And that's the truth. Amen? Listen to Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 and 3. Here's what it says. Here's how it describes our prior condition prior to our conversion. And you were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you formerly walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, of the spirit that is now working in the sons of disobedience. And among them we too all formerly lived in the lusts of our flesh, indulging the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, even as the rest. Wow. You see, that's the way we all were prior to conversion. That's the way we all were prior to the time the Holy Spirit brought us into Christ. That's the way we all were before the Holy Spirit made his entrance into our life and now lives within us. That's the way we used to be. That's not the way we are now. You got to understand, there's been a change made in you. Did you notice that by nature part? Here's what it says again. Let me read it to you once again. It said, indulging the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath. You see, apart from the indwelling Holy Spirit, we will naturally live apart from God a very selfish, self-centered, self-indulging life. What's the essence of sin? Selfishness. Pick any sin you want. I don't care what it is. Any sin you want, at the heart and root of that sin is selfishness. Well, I wanted it, so I took it. Well, it felt good to me, so I did it. I don't care what sin it is. At the root and heart of it is selfishness. And when we get convinced, even by the tempter, even by the lurer, who says, well, that may be wrong for everybody else, but it's okay for you. Because after all, you're different. You're special. You can handle it. That's selfishness. It's feeding that ego that says, well, it may be everybody else wrong for them, but not for me. Are you with me so far? You see, we just cannot live righteously on our own. We just don't have the power to do so. John the Baptizer preached that Jesus would baptize us in the Holy Spirit, Mark chapter 1, verse 8. In John chapter 14, verse 16, Jesus himself promised to do it. Here's what he said. I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may be with you forever. That is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it does not see him or know him. But you know him, because he abides with you and will be in you. While Jesus was walking with them, the Holy Spirit was not there to do that. When Jesus said, I'll go away and I'll send the helper, and he'll come not just to be with you. Now that I'm away, he can abide in you. And that's exactly what happened. Acts chapter 1, verse 8, Jesus said, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. What power? Will we receive authority? Some. The authority God wants us to have. Will we receive ability? Absolutely. What ability? The ability to live righteously. You will receive what? Power. You will receive what? Power. Do it one more time. You receive what?
Power.
The ability to live righteously. In the upper room of Mark's house, he did it. They were all gathered together. They had a 10-day prayer meeting. They were fasting and praying. They were scared to death, didn't know what to do. Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, the Bible says the Holy Spirit came, did all these marvelous things. We get hung up on the marvelous things and kind of forget that the Holy Spirit came. By the way, he did it again with others in Jerusalem in Acts chapter 4, verse 31, and did it still more at Joppa in Acts chapter 11, verses 13 through 17. Same thing, over and over. He keeps doing this. And he continues to baptize with the Spirit whenever people surrender themselves in faith to him. Is this some special experience for just the few? No, absolutely not. Paul made it clear this is the normal experience of every Christian. Being baptized by Christ in the Holy Spirit is not a symbolic ritual as in water baptism. It is how we get into Christ in the first place. Listen to me carefully. I know we have some people that teach you the baptism of the Holy Spirit is some secondary, second experience you have after conversion. I'm telling you that's not true. And I'm telling you from a biblical standpoint it's not true. I want to show you it's not true. It's not a secondary experience. It's the primary experience. It is the new birth experience. You want to see it? How many people want to see that? All right, I want you to take your Bible and turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 13. I have a lot of charismatic friends and a lot of Pentecostal friends. I had a Pentecostal nanny when I was growing up. Been to a lot of Pentecostal churches, preached in a lot of Pentecostal churches. At one time, I was vice president of Full Gospel Businessmen's Fellowship International in my hometown until they told me I had to believe a certain particular doctrine. I said, well, that's not in the Bible. They said, well, that's what we believe. I said, well, then you're believing something that's not biblically true. They said, well, if you don't believe that, you can't be our vice president. I said, that's fine with me. I don't care. I'll stay with the Bible. You guys stay with your little doctrine. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 13, for by one Spirit, by what? One Spirit, we were all, what? Baptized into one body. It's the baptism of the Holy Spirit, folks. This is the biblical baptism of the Holy Spirit. Not somebody's false doctrine about it. This is the biblical doctrine. You were all, that means everybody who knows the Lord Jesus Christ and is born of him, were baptized by the Spirit into the body of Christ. That's how you get here. Whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, we're all made, how many? All made to drink of one Spirit. Do you see that? That's the biblical doctrine of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. You need to know this. This is how we get into Christ. This is how we get saved. Salvation is not a matter of me making a decision. It is a supernatural divine work of the Holy Spirit that brings life into a human being that was once separated from God, dead in his trespasses and sins and so on and so forth, as Paul said back in Ephesians. This is a supernatural work of God. If there is not this supernatural work of God, or what we used to call travail of soul, anybody remember that old term, travail of soul? Back when you used to see sinners going through all this harangue because they recognize their sin and we're so blot out these days. We don't even recognize sin hardly. But people get all torn up because they were in their sin. They wanted to be free, and there was a birthing process, and Jesus said, this is the way of the kingdom of God. It's like coming through birth. You remember that? Some of you do, some of you say, I've never heard that before in my life. Okay. Hang in there. It's true. You can find it in the Bible. When you get saved, you are being birthed into the kingdom of God. Jesus said, you must be born again. This isn't just a simple decision. Ask any lady whether it was just a decision to have a child. Was it just a decision? You just decided today to have a child, tomorrow you had one? Huh? There's a process, right? A difficult process. I get it, sort of. There are things about that process I just don't really want to get, okay? But I understand, it's difficult. I was there, all four of mine, I was there in the delivery room, all four of mine. I was there when we went through all the Lamaze classes and breathe, honey, breathe. Look at me, breathe. You know, I get it. It's the same as birthing into the kingdom. It is a process that culminates in a new birth of a new child of God. And it's not an easy process. It is travail, and it's done by the Holy Spirit in conjunction with a sinner's repentance and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And when that happens, the Holy Spirit baptizes that person into the body. Romans 8 and 9 makes it clear that without that experience, we don't belong to Jesus. Here's what Romans 8 and 9 says. However, you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of Christ, Spirit of God dwells in you. But if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to him. How's that? That clear enough? Just want you to know it. I want you to realize that all power comes from God, whether we're talking about authority or whether we're talking about ability. And here we're talking about the authority to act as a child of God and the ability to live like a child of God. And here we're talking about how do we get there, because the Spirit of God has made his entrance into our life and changed us dramatically. What about all this other stuff, Dr. Ron? I mean, what about those people that believe in various things? Listen, I don't have a problem with supernatural. Don't come to me and say, well, you don't believe the supernatural. Oh, yes, I do. I believe in all the things that are in the Scripture. And I don't care if I'm a Baptist or not. I'm a believer before I'm a Baptist. I had a friend of mine say one time, well, don't you want to teach Baptist doctrine? I said, I just want to teach biblical doctrine. And you know what? If we're right about it, then what I'm teaching biblically should be what we're teaching as Baptists. But if that's not true, I'm going to stay with the Bible. Because I'm not going to stand before a holy God and he's going to say, did you keep to your Baptist doctrine? He's going to say, did you teach my word? So that's where we're going to go. It's where we're always going to go. Just as long as I'm here, that's where we're always going to go. Just want you to know that. Okay. But I also want to make sure that we are following biblical teaching, not man-made teaching. I believe that there are supernatural acts of God, and I believe God does supernatural kinds of things, and I'm not in the least bit afraid of that. And I am very glad when God does it. And I'd welcome it every Sunday if he'd do it right here. But I'm not going to teach you something that's not biblically true just because everybody else is saying this is the way you got to teach it. I want you to know part of the best life possible is the power that comes from God to be able to learn, to acquire things spiritually, to be able to love, people unconditionally, and to be able to live righteously in this world. Those are great things God has given us, and it's part of the best life possible. Amen? That's the reason why I put it in my significant seven DNA of the best life possible. So do you understand all that? Is that good by you? Listen, I hope so, because it starts with your giving your life to Jesus Christ and this supernatural work of the Holy Spirit that brings you into the body. Okay? That's where it starts. And you don't have anything whatsoever to be afraid of when it comes to the supernatural God of this universe, because he is committed to your best interest by his attitude and his actions. And he's committed that way unconditionally. Isn't that cool? He is unconditionally committed to your best interest. Wow. Awesome stuff. Awesome stuff. So you have nothing to fear from him. So if you're kind of worried about God, don't be. He loves you with a passion so deep you can't even fathom it. He is committed to you so greatly you don't even understand it. And he has so many things to pour out and give to you that you have yet to receive that you can't fathom with your eye or your ear what those things are. But it starts with your putting your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, repenting of your sin, placing your trust in the Lord Jesus, and asking him to come into your heart and be your Lord and Savior. That's where it begins. If you haven't done that, you need to do that immediately. Don't even delay. Don't put that down. Don't take that home. Just right now, bring it into your heart. And Christian, I want you to stop referring to yourself as a sinner. Start thinking of yourself rightly. You are a saint, born of the Spirit of God, brought into the family of God, washed by the blood of Christ, filled with the Holy Spirit, and you belong to God, and you are a child of God, and you need to start thinking of yourself that way and acting that way. That's who you are. That's not who you used to be, but that's who you are. Amen? Father, we thank you for this time together around your word. Thank you for the teaching you've given us today. Thank you for the challenge that it's brought to us. Thank you for the struggle we have with verbiage that gets us all confused. But thank you for the truth of your word, that we can put off all those things that others have put onto your word and see the truth for what it is. Bless us now, Father, we may live the truth in a daily way. In Jesus' name, amen.